Okay. So I will present the new feature for the coming release of Triton, which will be the version 4.2. And since we do one conference every year and we do two releases every year, I will show already what was in 4.0 and to catch up with the new feature compared to the last conference. The first thing is that we have a new way of authenticate the user, and we have a module where you can authenticate using SMS code. So I cannot directly show you the authentication with SMS code because we need an SMS provider, but the difference you will see with the current client is that now the login windows doesn't ask you for a password anymore because this is customizable. And when you start to log, he asks to the server which kind of authentication. And so for now, it's just with password. But we have a module that can send an SMS to the user and with a code. And you put the code, and it will authenticate the user. So, and this can be done also in combination with password. So we can ask the password and after that the SMS code, which makes it a two-factor authentication, which is stronger than just password. So that's a new feature that's nice for environment where there is a big need of hard authentication and security. The notes. On now, what you will see, so this is the standard interface of Triton. And if you go to any record, for example, the parties, and you open it, okay, you will see now that we have a small icon here, a new icon, which allow you to add a note on any record. If you open it, it will bring you the list of all the notes if you want to. This is it's a little bit too much on the laptop. Okay. And here you will see all the notes that are added by the different users, and you can create a new note, type some stuff on it. Check something. Okay, you can validate, and now what you will see is that I'm the author of the note, so I don't see anything about my new note. But if I log as another user, I will create quickly another user. So I'm the user demo, and I go to the same record, and now I see that there is a notification here. You see the small star? We don't see very well. So here, you see there is one note, and it's just to warn me that someone left a note on this record, and I didn't read it yet. So if I open it and I look at the note, It's a little bit slow, but okay. So I can see the notes here. And once I look at it, I read it. Now, if I close the pop-up, the note is marked as read, and so I have no more notes to read on the record. That's a way to communicate, a simple way to communicate about specific records or party and stuff like that. And it's available for it's the mark of what you have read is per user. So each user will have the notification each the first time they see the note. Okay. By the way, if anyone has a question, I think we can just ask now, and we will. I think it's better to create a kind of discussion if you have something to say about one of the features. Okay, that's the note. We have also something new, which we name the counting on the tabs. If we can see it, for example, on the cell form. So you see now on each tab for each state, we have a counting of how much records there is in this tab. So that allows the user to know, okay, there is 18 quotations, so I have to push them or to validate them or call the customer to perform some actions. This is good because now, in a quick look, you can see the state and what is in the pipe in some way. You don't have to go to each tab to know how much records you have. And this is refreshed each time you make a new query. So if I search for a simple party, I think there is electric. The counting is based also on my search. So the number here are different because it shows me only the sale for the electricity customer. And so it's also, it works this way. Okay. And it's refreshed, and in some way it doesn't block you to go. It's done on background, and so it has no performance issue about opening the form. Yeah? No, the developer has to activate it. Because you will see here, we don't count the old tabs, because in some way we don't care about the all the past sale, and we don't want to spend too much resource on counting always all the invoice. So yeah, that's something that needs to be activated, and in some way carefully activate, because we should be, it could have a cost if it's done on tabs that have too much records. Nicolas? We have a GIF for each person who asks a question. Like that, to push everybody to participate. So if you ask a question, you can have a small badge.
Any question? Any kind of question?
No, a good question.
You get a question when you don't ask.
Yeah?
How?
He doesn't care about the pagination. So it counts everything. Even if you are, it's the list start to paginate. So the desktop client, it's 1,000 records. It will still count everything. But if you have more than 100 records, it will just show you 99 plus. And if you put the cursor on it, it shows you the real number. So like that, if you have a very large number, it doesn't take all the place on the screen. And, but you can still see with the tooltip the real numbers. I don't think I have a place where I have so much. Yeah, but I have to create 100.
Duplicate a couple of or three iterations that you're going to have.
Okay, if you want.
Well,
it can take some time on my laptop. Yeah. I have a very small laptop, so it will take time. I think it's not useful to show. But maybe there is this translation. Maybe it's, no, I know where we can find one, I think. I have only one. Well, no, that's complicated. But you will see, maybe, if you make a lot of records. it becomes 99 plus and. Yeah, the read-only on the list field, you will see. So we have what we call the one-to-many fields. So indeed, it's a list inside the formula, a form. And until now, for example, on the sale, when the sale was confirmed, the list was read-only, and so you cannot modify any record on it. But now, the way the fields are marked as read-only is more fine. It's not because the list is read-only that the records inside the list are also read-only. So we cannot here add new records because it's a confirmed sale. But I can open one and still add a note on it. If I want to update with some talk with the customer about and put some information. So we think it's useful because it allows more stuff to do, and it's finer. But you will see that other fields that are important, like the quantity or the price, you cannot edit it. If I try here, it's not allowed. So that's an improvement, we think. And it's applied on all the models on all the form in Triton, so it's there for to be used. Okay. Yeah, big stuff. We removed the database management from the client. So you will see here, the name is no more database, of course, on the menu, because there is no more database management. It's just about the connection. We did it because there were some security issues with providing the database management remotely to the user. We get a password, but to protect this kind of services was a little bit complex to provide the best techniques about authentication and stuff like that. So we preferred to remove it and let the database management to the developer or the operators and not to the end user. Because, yeah, that's something we think it's better like that. And of course, for people who do hosting, they will have to provide an external application if they want to provide, again, this functionality. The search on the name now, if I don't know if you know about that. If you create, if you are looking for, searching for example, a customer when you are doing a sale, I don't know, let's search for mobile center. I don't have it, but I can now click on create because I didn't find it, and automatically on the form that will open quickly, my search is automatically put on the name. So I don't have to type it again. So Triton knows that when you search on the name, indeed the value you are looking is this field, and he automatically fill it the right field. It helps the user. You have to type less. Okay. Derivative translation. So we have reworked it all the way translation works. Before, we required to have language code based on the language and the country. And now we have allowed to use only the language code. So you can have ES for Spanish, or EN for English, or FR for French. And you don't need to have the suffix for the country. But you can create one with for one country. So you can have ES_ES for Spain. And automatically, it will look, if it doesn't find a translation in this language, it will look for the translation in the two letters code for the Spanish. So this is very, now with this, you can easily create a derivative translation for your own use without having to translate everything. You inherit from the parent language and just modify the few strings that you want to change. And for the Spanish, we made that. So now we have only one language, yes, for all the Spanish. And we have one derivative for the South America, which is different. And we grouped them all together to simplify because we have we started to have a very big proliferation of Spanish translation that looks all the same. And so it was a waste of resource and so on. A big thing with this new coming release is the possibility to create user application. And I will show you one that I wrote to encode timesheet, which I named Kronos. The user application is small application dedicated to one task. And we want to be able to perform this task very quickly and easily for the user and so on. For that, we don't want to have authentication. So if each time you want to enter your timesheet, you have to type your password. It's a bit boring, and so the goal is to get the user or the employee to enter their timesheet as soon as possible, so it should be very easy. So I will show you how Kronos works. So it's an extension of the browser, and you can see it's here. It's a small icon. We will publish it on the Chrome market and the Firefox market, so you will be able to find it there. So when you install it, you just have the small icon here. You can click on it. It will open the settings. So I have to fill to tell him where is the server. So I will type the address of my server. So it's localhost. here, my the name of the database and my username. So I will use demo. And I ask just to register. So he told to the server, and he creates a key here. I see the first letters of the key. And he asked me to go to my to the Triton client. So here it is. I will log as demo user. No. And I need to go to my preferences. And there, on the preferences, I have a new tab application. And I see this is the key it generated for me. And I can validate the key if I'm this is the key I created, so I know it's not someone who tried to access to my account. So I validate the key. I close. I will just quickly link the employee to the user to an employee because it's for timesheet, so we need to be an employee. Okay. So now, if I go back to my user application and I open it, it automatically put the date on today, and I can start encoding time. So I make 2 hours. I have no work, so I have no work to do. maybe I need to have a timesheet permission. Not sure. Ah no, wait. I didn't say I work for this employee, I think. So now I have the work. So I can say I work it 2 hours for what do we have? Marketing. And I can just click save and it's saved. If I go back to the here, I can see the timesheet I just filled here, this one. I will filter for okay. Okay, you can see this one. And the good thing about this application is that it works offline. So I will stop the server. Okay, trust me, it's the server running, and I stop it. And now I can still open the application and add new timesheets. 1 hour of design. I can save. It's still working. If I go to the client, where is my client? You can see here, the server is not running. It's just to be sure. I start back the server. And indeed, the plugins, the web application, will try to connect and refresh the data once the server is up. Start. Up. So we don't see yet because it tried every 5 minutes. Indeed, it detects if the browser is offline, but here it was not offline because I disconnect the server. And otherwise, it tried every 5 minutes. So to show you, I will add another timesheet. Because when he adds a new timesheet, it should it push all the other unsaved timesheets. What? Here you see the 1 hour and the one and. So this is the one that I created offline, and this one, the new one. And it keeps updating like that. So what? The data? It's stored in the local storage of the browser. So I think we have a few mega, 50 mega that we can store. And it also gets some cache because here, it keeps here, I can browse back in time and go forward. It keeps 1 month in the cache of data. So you can see what you encoded in the past and make adjustment, even if you are not online. And you will synchronize back when you could. And after that, he drop the cache, except if you have made change that he could not yet push. So you normally you will never lose one change on your timesheet. If you delete it and no, it will detect it's deleted, so it will consider that your change is no more valid because it was about something was deleted. But I don't expect really to have this kind of use case because people encode their own timesheet and normally nobody else will delete them by the back. So. Yeah?
Does this work only on what browser?
It's Chrome. No, it works also on Firefox. It uses the web extension API. I will make a talk tomorrow about how it works internally. But I show you on Chrome because my version of Firefox doesn't allow to install plugins that are not signed by Mozilla. So, yeah. Can you have? Yeah. Yeah. We have the list of here. Yeah?
And the second question is this code is made in JavaScript.
Yeah?
Part of it is
I guess the, it has the same API. It uses the same thing as SAO.
That SAO? No. No, it doesn't use the same API for as SAO. I will talk tomorrow about the API. It's a dedicated API, and it's a kind of REST API. But you can create your own syntax for your own application if you want. So okay. The important thing is that it doesn't require authentication, because we use here the, a key. And this key is stored on the browser. And it's used only to encode timesheet for this user. You cannot do anything else than timesheet encoding with this key.
No, I mean, it has the same session as the...
No, there is no session.
OK.
If you delete a browser cache, you have to register a new key, or I sometimes delete browser
I don't. Cache. It depends on what you mean by deleting the browser cache. It's not really part of the cache of the browser. It's the local storage. Of course, you can go to the settings of your browser and delete the local storage, and then you have lost your data, and the key, you don't have anymore the key, so you have to create a new one and validate it. And you can delete also the previous one. Here on the settings, you can always, if you think your key has been compromised, you can always click here on reset. It will delete the key on the server and forget about everything on your local storage and start again. Yeah, it's a possible improvement. But personally, I think that doesn't always give you a good value. But yeah, we could have you store the starting time, and when you click on stop, you make the difference and you feel the value. That's a possible improvement.
In fact, I discussed with a lawyer 2 or 3 days ago, and I asked her do they register their time? And I was thinking they were clicking on start somewhere and then type the stuff and so on. But no. Indeed, what they do, they have a special program where they put the amount of time spent, what they have done, and voila, it's okay. They don't use start and stop program.
It's we use it at Nantip. I know other companies that are using it.
So sometimes you have some company policy where you run the time to 5 minutes or 50 minutes. But yeah, that's possible. I don't. But it's welcome. also, I think we can create other similar application for other usage. One I've yesterday is we could have a similar application that where you store your receipt. When you go to a restaurant, you make a picture of the receipt and it's sent to the server when you are back online. I think there is a lot of kind. Similar application, or for production, we could have also this kind of application, because we could make the same kind of application as a mobile application. And so, when you are on some site where you don't have a keyboard and you need, so you don't want to enter a password each time you start working on something. And you just say, okay, I'll take this order and work. So yeah, I think there is plenty of small application that could be done like that. Yeah.
May there be any, thank you. May there be any syncing conflicts?
Yeah, you could. The last one will win. So in this case, for timesheet, I think it's not an issue because normally you are the only one, except if you duplicate yourself. But so I don't think we should worry about conflict in this specific case. So I didn't really worry. It will be the last update will win. So yeah, but of course, if you write something more complex, you have to take care of this, and you are not. It's not required to make it work offline. You can make an application that works only online and prevent any conflicts. No more question? Okay. Another change is that we get in the application many fields where we have to encode a number of day. And this number of day was not always clear, and sometimes we wanted to be able to say half a day or something smaller, and we changed it for a new field that we have now, which is what we call time delta, but that's technical name. For example, you can find it on the lead time for delivery a product here. And indeed, it's a field where you can type 5 day, and it will show you keep 5 day. For developers, it's time delta, so it's really easy to use. But you can say also 1 month. No. It was one minute. 1 month is with an uppercase M. And so it's much more easier than to have to type what is 1 month. Is it for the company 20 days or 31 or and so on. And of course, yeah, and it can go also for a year. 1 year. It works also, and we have months, week, and so on. So it's easier to type and cleaner. I hope it's translatable. So it's the values here are translatable. So for your language, it will be I guess G for Netherlands and
Inyar.
Ah, I don't think. Yeah, but it could be an improvement. Yeah, and maybe we could also have a tooltip, dynamic tooltip, where it's expand to say 1 year. But yeah, it's something you need to teach to the user. I think we this. We should maybe have it in the help also to improve. But by the way, the tags here, it's customizable. You can create your own small unit and define it as a specific amount of time. Two? Ah, it will be 2 minutes. Oh, 2 seconds. That probably there is room for improvement on the widget.
Is that
the default is. It depends. Depends of your business, but when there is nothing, it shows you zero, no time, no. Yeah, that could be an improvement. Yeah. Yeah, we have also now a wizard to replace a party by another party. So often what you have with, especially with the party, is that your user are creating duplicate party. They are created many times because someone didn't find or type wrongly. And you have your database is no more correct because you have duplicate records and you cannot have a clear picture of what is doing one party is doing in your system. So we create a wizard that will allow you, you find, okay, I've those two parties, they are the same, it was a mistake, so I will replace one by the other, and it will replace in all the system the party with the new one. And so the old one will be kind of removed of the system, and you will create only now, everything will be merged into one party. And this merge all the accounting stuff, so if the two party is opening receivable, they will be merged into one receivable. So you will not lose invoice from this party because you merge it into a new one. The current sales order and so on will be also replaced by the new party. So mostly everywhere we can, it will be replaced. And the wizard is pretty simple because you have it here, replace. So I will replace this party, and I have just to select another one. And I can pick. Up. And the wizard helps you because it will make some check to be sure that you are not doing a wrong replacement. So here it tells me, yeah, you want to replace this party by this other one, but they don't have the same name. It's probably a mistake. Are you sure that you want to make the replacement? And it does like that many checks on the name, on the VAT code, if it's the same and so on. Yeah, for example, it can be extended. For now, we just check names and identifier, so VAT code and other kind of code you could have added. The address is a little bit more complicated because a party could have multiple addresses. And in some way, but the address is not merged. They are moved from one party to another party. So you could still have duplicate address on the new one because we copy all the addresses from the party you are replaced by to the new one. So the address is not really a good, I don't think it's really a good thing to try to match, but it could be done if you.
Sure.
Yeah, it's inactivated. So it's a logical deletion because we don't replace everywhere. The developer has to say, okay, this field I allow to be replaced. And for example, I think the invoice, we don't replace the party. Because we want to have the data we get when we create the invoice. But we do it for accounting lines because it's not a requirement. And so, yeah.
So is it possible to extend this wizard from third-party module?
To extend?
To extend this wizard with
yes.
A new logic.
Indeed, each module has to declare, okay, there is a method, and you can extend it, and you can declare, in my modules, this field party you can replace, and it will do only if you declare it. So it's you have to. It's not magical, so you have to say what you want to do. First.
And yeah, do we have a kind of wizard that could help you to identify duplicates?
Not now. It could be something interesting to do. to search for similar records name. It could be expensive if you have a lot of party, because you have to match each one with each one. But we do it for translation. When you update the translation, we match, we find similar translation using the Liefenstein distance. But and so it's a way to say those two sentences look similar. We could, it could be done. But there is first.
We started a module to search, and it's very hard with a lot of records. So we do a direct query and send a Liefenstein measure distance.
Maybe it's doable in Postgres. I think they have tools for that to measure distance between text, maybe in extension, so it's maybe doable.
It could be nice if the configuration could be done through the client. For example, I want to search for all the parties that have the same name, or then a second search where I want to find all the parties that which have the.
Here you can search.
Yeah, but I want to launch a wizard with the same rule. Find me all the parties that have the same name, the same CRN, or the same. For example.
Yeah.
Because if you have, every time you want to develop a module to create a new rule, it's pretty complicated.
Yeah, no, of course. If such wizard will be created, it should be configurable like the checks done in this wizard. Of course, it should use the same checks, I guess.
What you do is you change all the names you want.
Yeah. We update it with SQL, like that we skip all the checks from the ORM, even if it's not allowed to modify the record, we do it on the run. And we also add, if the record, the model is historized, we create a history record. So you know you have the history of the change. And also we store the replacement of the party. So the party that is replaced, we have a field that it was replaced by this party. So you know.
Okay. After merging, is there a way for rolling back?
No.
Okay.
That's why we put checks to be sure that you you don't make mistakes. Or in some way you. For some records, you could still try to go back manually, but it will be a lot of work.
Is it the module or is it people party?
It's in the standard module.
And is it so that the user needs to write?
Yeah. Yes, there is a special group for that. So not everybody is allowed to make this kind of.
Do you recheck the domains and things like that
No.
after?
No, the idea is that if it's something that you will write, use later, and it's not valid, then you will have to make it correct when you try to, for example, sell order, if you try to quote it or to validate, it will be checked and it will tell you there is something wrong, so you have to fix it. And for past stuff that you cannot change, if it's already validated, post it in the accounting. What's the point to, if it could happen?
Try not to be stuck in a check.
Yeah, but for stuff that are at the end of life in some way, they will no more be changed. You don't need to check it.
Let's say you are in the process. Maybe something you change.
That's why you have to declare the field that you allow to change. So if for you, you have put constraint on the party of the sale, probably you should remove it from the wizard and say we cannot replace there. It's not a big issue. We did, for example, we modified the address. This is because there is a constraint that the address of the to deliver the sale should be the address of the buyer. So we moved the address to the new party to be sure that the domain is still valid. In the system for now, it's mainly the only constraint we have between party and otherwise, most of the document duplicate the property of the party at the moment you create the document to prevent to have weird effects later when you change the party. Because the same issue could happen if you just edit the party and change something in the configuration of the party. If you change the payment term, I think if you have this kind of case, there is maybe a problem in the design. You should store on the document the values. Okay. No more questions? Yeah.
If you have an own model who has a reference to the party, and you merge that party with another one,
the reference reference fields, you mean?
Yes.
Okay.
Does it only work with the standard models, or? Do I have to take care if I make a reference in my
If you make a reference in your module, you have to take care in your modules about this field.
Okay. Thank you.
It's an opt-in feature. We have a new format for the address, which is much more generic and works for many different countries. I will show you how it looks. So this is the new design. Indeed, what you can see is that the field that was called name of address, we rename it into building name because it was often misunderstood. People thought it was the name of the contact or whatever. It is the name of the building. So like that, it's really clear, and you will not make an issue. The address, the street, indeed, it's multiple lines, and you can put as much line as you want, because not in every country you have only two streets. Sometimes it's bigger or smaller. So here you have the freedom to put whatever you want, and you still have the zip code, the city, country, and the subdivision, which works as previously. This is still like that because there you can enforce. We have completion. You can load your zip code for your country, and you have automatically the city name, fill it, and stuff like that. And this is useful. But the new stuff is that this is what we have in the form. This is the way we standardize the filling of the address. But how you put it on the envelope or you print it somewhere change is different for each country, indeed. And so we have here fill it for many countries. We don't have all the countries because we need information for all of them. But you have the format to use to format the address. And you have all the fields available here. And so it should include the name of the party, because you always print an address for someone. So it should contain the name of the party, because it's not always on the top, the name of the party. In some countries, at the bottom. I think in China, for example, it's at the bottom. You have here the tooltip that tells you all the fields that are available. And you can have the uppercase version by just typing the same name with uppercase. So usually, the country, you should put it in uppercase. This is a kind of standard everywhere. But and you can put, for example, here, the zip code and the city on the same line, if it's how it is done in your country, and so on. For example, you can also put a different format depending of the language. In China, the format is different if you write it for in Chinese or in European, using the European character. For example, in China, you have first the country, the zip code. It's some way from the larger group to smaller. And if you go to the standard way, it's a different, it's the same. Indeed, but I think they use comma here. So we have a lot of different formats. For example, for France, they used to put the city name in uppercase, where for in Belgium, we don't do. We have, for Spanish, I think, the problem is I don't see all the screen on my laptop. Okay, for Spain, this is the format you get.
Sometimes we need at least the country two different alphabets.
You see, for example, if you write from France to Russia, you have different alphabets. So you absolutely have to write Russia in French, Russie, in French characters, so the postman in France know that it has to go there.
Yeah, but I think.
But then in Russia, they have to understand that it is for Russia in Cyrillic characters.
Are you sure about that? Because I read kind of guidelines from the American Postal, and they just say to write the country in the language from where you send it, and not for where it's going. But
okay, so it is a standard, and it's okay.
That's
okay.
What I wrote, but there is no real standard, indeed. there is.
I'm not sure because if you put the country, how can you choose to take a specific translation for?
Yeah, we don't. There is no.
It doesn't work.
This feature doesn't exist.
Yeah.
So. But if there is the need, it's doable. But there is a question there.
I read a little bit about German post services, and if I remember correctly, they say once it reached the final country, then the country information is not useful for the postal service there. So you write the country of where it have to go in the same nation you are posting it.
And indeed, it's often better even to write it in English because it's kind of the standard language, and everybody knows the country in English. And, but yeah, that. Yeah, what we the choice here is to let it free. So if you're in your country, you do like that. But if you really want to have the house number coded in your address, you can extend and put a field house number. Indeed, there is here in this form there is room to add a new set of fields here.
We indeed, cannot see it.
There is three columns, but the last one is always empty. And so you could put an extra field there if you really want to have the house number, if you want to validate it or something like that, you can put it. But it's specific to each country and each usage. But the idea is to be able to write any addresses from anywhere in the world into the system without any issue. Yeah?
So now that name has turned into building name, for those of us who have been using that to keep track of individuals at a company that's a contact of ours,
yeah?
Where do you keep track of the individuals?
Indeed, you have the contact mechanism, which normally should be, when you used the name of an address as a kind of contact, it should be a contact mechanism, or you should use the relationship modules, the party relationship modules, where you create a new party for, if you want to track the employee of a company, to know this person is an employee of this company, you should use the party relationship module where you create relation between parties. Indeed, each individual should be a party. It should not be a small stuff defined on one party, because it could be this person could become one day a customer or a supplier or whatever. And the idea is to be able to track all the stuff. Yeah. So, and yeah, and the address is the address.
I have many requests to make more to make richer the contact fields. And have some functionality around that. The problem I found up to now is that we never found a standard way of doing that. Mm-hmm. But I think that custom modules to add some functionality, like an agenda, to mimic cards or whatever, could be useful for many customers. Letting, for example, appear some instruction for the contact or dependencies between the lines, the means of contact.
Here? The one?
Yeah.
Dependency?
Well, for example, who is the secretary of this person?
In some way, it should be a relation between the two parties.
Between the two contacts?
Between the two parties.
Well, no. The standard of the boss of the company is not a party.
Yeah.
It is the standard, the reception desk.
Okay.
Is not a party for this here. Okay.
If you want to store, it should be a party because if you want to store his email.
No, I don't want. The point is that when you put a contact, this is the boss. This is when the boss will be on holidays. And this is the backup contact when he's not in. This is the kind.
Okay, here.
This is the kind of instruction we often need to customize, to make it more more rich.
You have a small...
You have a comment, so we could put the first letters of the comment in the main list, but of course it's just MacGyver. MacGyver solution. Okay. We may have a specific thought about that.
Maybe.
Because it's a recurrent demand to have something like a real list of contacts with options,
when to use this contact.
His phone number when
to
urgency.
Use this contact. Indeed.
Yes, for example, the hours and the backup number for calling when he's not in and so on.
The contact mechanism could be extended to be more powerful.
Yes, if we can make progress on that, it will be appreciated.
Yeah. Okay.
In which parts it's already working this format in the labels, for example, and where
what?
this new form?
In all standard document of Triton,
the report, sale,
yeah. Reports, in the invoice, in the purchase, in everywhere the addresses was used and formatted. In any report, it's used. And it's pretty simple. Indeed, you have a method on the party that gives you the address, formatted. And so you just call the method and you put it on the report and it's done. You have on the party and you have, as if I remember correctly, on the address. And if you format just the address, you don't have the party name field. And I didn't say, but the formatting always remove empty lines. So if you don't have subdivision, you don't have an empty line. It will be removed and everything will be stuck together. No, c'est plus trop. Ah. What?
You already have one.
We have reworked the product and the variant form. For those who have used it previously, in the last, in the two or three last version, it was a little bit complicated because we removed the fact that we show the variant as a really with the same layout as the template. So now we have a way to do it back again, but in a more in a better way. So this is the form for, it is a template indeed, because here you have the variant. And if you go to a variant, you will see that you have the same form. I open the same, the variant of the product. And you will see, indeed it's almost the same design. And it is almost because it's reused. So if you change the template, the change made on the template will be automatically applied on the variant. But with the difference that all the fields that come from the template are read-only. So for example, the default unit, I cannot edit it from the variant because it's come from the template. And you see the template here. It's just the new field that is added. Where you have the variant here with the description, you just have the description. But otherwise, everything else is kept as is. So now, when the user opens the product form, for example, from the sale order, it will see a full form instead of just the product name and a link to the variant, to the template. And so we think it's more easier to understand for the end user. And if you create a variant, you have to fill the template and automatically all the fields are, all the read-only fields are filled with the value.
Is it something specific to product and template, or
yes.
Is it something generic to
display me into? It's specific, but you can reuse the same patterns if you want. Indeed, it's a little bit technical, but we create on the fly function fields for all the fields that are missing in the variant that come from the template.
Couldn't be a mix-in?
It's not done with a mix-in. We have a specific function field, which is a little bit customized, but you can reuse it, you can import it.
Because we often have the need to display a Mini2N, all the fields of the Mini2N. Different
yeah.
Fields.
It's almost the same. Yeah, but here it's done automatically. So the only thing is that if you change in a module, you add a field on the template, you have to make a new to register a product model. Also, even if you don't add any field, anything, to be sure that it's synchronized with the template. Okay. The categories on the product. So you will see that we don't have any more a category on the product. We don't have a category because we have here a list of categories. So we have more than one categories for a product. So now the categories can be used as a larger tree structure for categories. This can be used, for example, for an e-commerce web shop where the same product could be in different categories and so on. But we add the feature that we wanted to keep it, is to be able to get the default accounting configuration from the category. And so we introduce an account category. And the account category is indeed here. The categories can be flagged, if I open one, as an accounting category. And once it's the top categories marked as an accounting categories, all the children categories are also accounting categories. So all the three should be of the same type. And this, if it's marked as an accounting category, it can be used in the product definition here as the accounting category. And if you add here the accounting categories, it will be automatically added to the categories. Okay? It's a lot of categories, but this design is also duplicated for other properties that we inherit from different kind of categories. I think we have categories for don't remember, but we have other flags here that can be added, and it's extendable. And of course, you can mix. You can make a category that is accounting and something else. I think it's for the assets, but I'm not sure anymore. Or okay. Product classification. So product classification is a little bit like categories, but more stricter. It is here. Indeed, you can define a different kind of classification. By default, we have the cultivar, the taxon. It's for agriculture. And it's linked to different objects. The issue with categories is, indeed, we have only a name. And we cannot put specific information for a category. With the classification, it's a way to say, this is the product is this kind of stuff. So for example, it's a cultivar, so that means it's a plant, and they have some properties on the plant. You can, I don't remember exactly what we have here. So it has a taxon, it could be part of a group of categories. Classification, it's a little bit complex, but for plant, you could want to put the country of the origin country or stuff like that. That doesn't have sense for different kind of categories. So it's really a way to specialize your product. The idea is, for example, if you sell tables and chair, and you want to store some kind of property, to say, for example, this table has three legs or four legs, or that's something you cannot share with its values that are not, doesn't have any sense for something else. Chair, of course, with legs, but for a bicycle, you will use a specific classification for your specific kind of product, and you have two different classifications which are linked to two different forms with their own specific fields and so on. So it's a way to really specialize your product and define properties there. It's a more specialized than categories. Yeah. Okay? Yes, it's mainly only just text, except when you specialize it to be an accounting or something like that. But classification, yeah. Okay.
Is it in a separate module or a separate?
Classification, yes. No, it's standard. Tariko? Tariff code? Yeah. We have another modules, customs, which is at here on the product. I haven't installed it here. But we have a module for tariff. And for now, this module. Custom. I could quickly install it, I think. And it adds, you can add the tariff code and the tax rate depending on the country and so on. So we really modelize the international standard. And normally you could be able to compute if you fill all the data, the customs for your product. The tariff? The case for the company for which we create the classification and the taxon and cultivar classification, they sell fruit, fresh fruit, and the tariff classification is not precise enough for them. The tariff classification is kind of generic. They will talk about apples, but not all the different kind of apples you can have, for example. And so it's not enough for them, the tariff code. But and yeah, and you will see what I can. And also, our tariff object is just a code, the name, and the tax rate. But if we start to add properties for food, for I don't know, metals or whatever, we start to blow one model with a lot of fields and that are not used for all the cases. So it's not so good, I think. So. But of course, maybe you could have a kind of automatically filled if you put a specific classification, you could fill the tariff code that goes to. I'm almost at the end. Okay. Just to show the tariff code. Here it is. So, use a specific category for custom. This is where it was used. And you have here a list of tariff code. So you can inherit from the categories if you want. It's just the code and that's all. And you have a system of rules where you can compute the customs. We simplified the timesheet and the project work. So now, before when you create a project, you had to create also a timesheet work to be able to fill timesheet on it. And now the timesheet works are created automatically and they are just a reference to the project. It is used also for the production works. And so you have all the timesheets related stuff into one table, but they can be linked to different objects automatically. And you don't have to fill a name and so on. So now it's all, there is no more redundancy because the works take the name from the related record. So if I create a project where I say we can put timesheet on it, it will create a work that is related to the project and automatically has the name of the project. And the same for other kind of object like the production works Okay. The purchase request has now an exception state. So if there is an issue with the purchase, you have an exception on the purchase request. And you can say, OK, I will redo a new purchase for it or something and with another supplier or something like that. Before, we were a little bit stuck there. We can group the purchase request by product and unit. So if you select many purchase requests for the same product, we make only one line on the purchase where we group the we sum the quantity. Instead, before we created one line for each request, so you can some way have a better price like that. We have two new modules for shipping, which interface with UPS and DPD. It's shipping companies where we can communicate with them to get the labels to put on the package automatically, and it's register it and so on. And we expect to add more for other companies. We have put for the internal shipment also a lead time. So if you move the product from one warehouse to another warehouse, you can define the specific time it will take. So you can say it will take 1 day, and so your product will be unavailable during the day of the move. And so you just have to define it between this warehouse and this warehouse, it takes this time, and automatically the internal shipment will be split into two moves, and it will use a transition location. So, yeah. We can show the quantities you have for a lot in your warehouse. So it's useful if you look at a specific product to know where it is, in which location, and so on. The accounting report. Indeed, we have made a lot of improvement for the accounting reports using a new design way of designing it. If I open, for example, the general ledger, instead of directly printed, you have a list with, on the top, the selection of what you want to see for your general ledger. So you can select the fiscal year, the period. And when you change here, the values in the list are updated automatically. And of course, you can also print it as usual. So the idea is now you can make search, print only a part of it, and so on. You can select and have more options for it. That's for the general ledger. And we have also for the, it's not the, so it's the same for every report, accounting reports we have. And now also for some, you can have compare the values for one date compared to another. So if here I selected comparison, and now if I refresh, I have here the amount for this year and the amount for the previous year. So I can compare between two dates, and it's dynamic. So when I click, the columns appear and disappear. We have that for balance sheet and the income statement, I think. And of course, yeah, and you can extend, and everything is as usual, but you can search on it. Yeah?
Nice feature. Could you think of adding more comparison dates so that you can apply?
Not really. But it could be customized. The tools are there, and if you want to add more buttons, you can add more buttons. But I think for by default, two is already, it's the common practice. But okay.
And the comparison is also for the profit and loss?
The income statement?
Yeah,
yeah, I think so. Normally, yes. Yeah.
And it's only by
fiscal year or period? Yeah. The balance sheet is always per date and income statement per period. Okay. And all reports have been rewritten like that. And we encourage you to do the same for your custom report, because it gives the user more power, because they can filter, they can search on it, and really define what to see. And they don't need always to print, because it's expensive. If you have a lot of records, and sometimes it's just to check one value or something like that. So, okay.
How about budgeting?
What?
Budgeting. Budgets, creating budgets.
Ah, yes. Not yet. there is a blueprint, but we don't have yet a module for that. The idea is to be able to make a budget for accounting and analytics. But yeah. And of course, we will have a comparison if we add one day this module. Analytics, there was a lot of work done on analytics to simplify it. And what we do now is that we have, in the processing, you can have here a list of analytic lines that are not completely, a list of move lines that are not completely set up into analytics. So the idea is that all your profit and loss lines should be linked to all your axes of analytics. And instead of making it required when you post the move, we show you just those that are not yet done. So you can fill it when you encode your invoice or your sale, you can fill the analytics. But if you leave it empty, we will ask you later here to fill it for this or this line. That's a way to ensure that your analytics plan is complete. In some way, to get a clear picture, all your profit and loss line should be linked to an analytic account, at least. We have a view for that. And we simplified also the lines for analytics. I don't know. I should create. I think we can go faster. If someone has a question, we can see. We support analytics on the assets. So now, if you make an invoice for an asset, we don't put analytics directly because it doesn't go to profit and loss. But when the asset is depreciated, this goes to profit and loss, and this is when the analytics is filled. So it's more accurate. The dunning, we can now define fees on dunning. So for late dunnings, it will create automatically a fees for the customer who didn't pay. And you can customize depending on the level of the dunning, the price, and it can be a percentage of the amount or a fixed amount. The credit notes are gone. They are replaced by negative quantity, invoice with negative quantity. So it simplifies everything. That's easier. And now we can take care if you create credit notes from sales, we can now re-invoice what was credited and stuff like that. So it simplified for the developer the codes, but it's an important stuff to know as a user.
Does that have an impact on the revenue per customer then?
Does it have an impact then?
If you issue a negative quantity invoice, does that correct the revenue per customer? And does it have an impact on?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
If you make it will be like when you do a credit note, so it will credit the customer account.
Okay, so you, in the end, you will see the real amount that you have invoiced.
Yes, yes, okay. Of course.
Okay. Thank you. So, why?
Yeah. Indeed, what we did is that for taxis, it's taxis doesn't work the same way if it's a normal invoice or a credit note. You have to report different tax code and stuff like that. And what we do now is, if it's a negative quantity, we consider it as a credit note.
On the line or on the
invoice? On the line. And if your invoice is only negative quantities, we put a number of a credit note. Otherwise, it's numbered as an invoice, even if the amount is negative at the end. So as far as you have one line with a positive quantity, it's an invoice. If it's an invoice with all the lines with negative quantity, yeah, we use the numbering of the credit notes.
And if you don't want that, can you just...
You can use the same numbering as the invoice. Okay. You use the same sequence and you will be transparent. Yeah, now we have just a small wizard on the payments where you can block it. So. You have filled your payment for a supplier, you are in conflict with him, and you don't want anyone to pay the supplier, so you can say, this payment, we block it, so we cannot process it until it's unblocked, and there is a warning and stuff like that. And to unblock, you need to be in a specific group, so you can manage your payments like that. Yeah, now we can proceed all different payments for different currency, and we will ask the journal for each currency. Before, it was not possible. You have only to select payments in the same currency because we ask it for only one journal, so now you can make it. It's more flexible. And if you encode the payment, and it's not yet finished, or you didn't yet put it on your statement, it already decreased the amount to pay for the invoice. It was something that was not synchronized for now, and both modules are not cooperative on that. Now, so when you make the payments, it doesn't make any accounting moves. But because you are waiting for the statement for the bank, that you receive really the money, and if you enter the lines on the statement for a payment, that you say, this is the money from this payment, it will make the payment succeed. Or if the amount is negative, because sometimes you receive the money, and the bank gives you the money, and after that, they take back the money because indeed the customer didn't get the money, so they take back from you, and so on your statement is a negative line, and if you link it to the payment, it will fail the payment, so you will be able to reprocess it and ask again the money to your customer. Before that, you have to manage it manually, and for the SEPA, normally there is a message for that gives you the state of the payments, but often the bank doesn't provide it, so you have to manage it from the statement. Yeah, production routing. We work it on production, and we made it. Now you can have routing. You can define routing for production. Let's go. Here, so a routing is how we are going to manage your BOM or proceed your BOM, and so we define here. I have a BOM to compute to produce a computer here. And to make a computer, I need a tower, a keyboard, a mouse, and so on. But when I defined the bun, I didn't specify how to build really the computer. I need to have the steps to make the computer. And so the routing is there to define that for a bun. And I have to define a set of steps. They are ordered. So first I have to assemble the pieces. After that, install the software, test it, and put it on the package. This is the simple step for the production. And this is the routing. And now on the production, you can define, you can say, I produce with this bomb and this routing. And automatically, this will create, let's take a running one. So here I produce the computer, I selected the bomb and also the routing. And automatically it creates for me the works that needs to be done based on the steps of the routing. And so I'll get back the operation and so the user could start to see the works. Here, and you can start to take one work for one production, start to work on it. So indeed, I cannot because it's a request, but so there you will be able to track the number of cycles you are doing for on this specific operation. So you will record the work of each worker. You can track the time and so on. And like that, you have a cleaner picture of your production and when you spend time on your production. As I said, a work can be linked to create automatically a timesheet, and so the employee can report the time spent on a specific work as a timesheet line. We have also, you can define your work centers. So it's a tree where you have multiple lines, assembly lines. And inside each line, you define work center where you say it's used for this kind of categories of work. So you have the, it's a little bit complex, but a work center is a place where you can do some task. And so you have a category that defines the task that you are able to do on this work center. And when you start the production, you define the top level of the lines on which you are going to produce. And it will automatically assign each work to each work center it finds inside the line. Is it OK? So if I go back to my production here, I have all my works, the operation, and so the works. And automatically, he selected for me the work center on which operation should be done. So the assembly to assemble pieces, I have to do it on the assembly line number 3, because I say I will produce on the line 3. Okay, and it does it for all the operation, depending on the kind of operation and he find the right work center to use. Like that, you can dispatch the load on all your lines. But it's, for now, it's manually. There is no optimization on that. Yeah? Yeah? It is done here. So when you make a production, indeed, you have here the inputs and the outputs. It's a stock move. So it moves products out of the location and put a new product in the storage.
Hosting?
No.
The routing is not linked to costing.
Costing, yes, see. Indeed, you can. When you define here on the routing, you have the operations. And the operation, you can is linked to a the work center. If I get one, you can define this work center as a cost, and you define how you compute the cost. You can say it's per cycle. So depending on how much time the workers will run the machine, it will cost a specific amount that we define here. Or it can be just based on the time. So when the worker starts to work, we register the starting time when he finished, and we get the time he spent it. And so we can compute the cost, and it's added back to the production here. On the production, we have the cost of the production. And so it's compute with the cost of the products you use and the cost of the works that have been done there. If you use the accounting stock modules with continental and Anglo-Saxon methods, it will create accounting move. That depends on the way you manage your stock accounting. Okay? Yeah. Go. So we have seen routing and works. We can also split production. So you split the quantity and it creates two production and so on. We can, as I said, register timesheet on the works. We support long running production, so you can have a different date between the start time and the end time of the production. That's allow you to track the whole time of the production, which is good for when you have long running production. And that's all.
Okay.
No question?